So you're hitting 700 in math pretty consistently, making around 7 mistakes per test, and you're probably thinking, hey, I'm inches away from an 800. Unfortunately, the truth is you're probably a lot further than you think, and here is why. As you near the top 1% of the curve, things get considerably harder, more complex, and less predictable. And the fact is that you will face diminishing returns on your efforts. And this is going to be true no matter what skill you're attempting to master. If you're aiming for a perfect score or top performance, the final points are simply going to be the hardest to get. And this is because the relationship between effort and improvement follows a Pareto distribution, where at first, a small amount of effort produces a large improvement, but as your score gets higher and higher, you will need to put in exponentially more time and energy into improving your score by smaller and smaller amounts. So basically, if raising your score from 600 to 700 takes you 10 hours, raising it from 700 to 800 could take you 100. And for most of you, the last 20 to 30 points will not be worth the effort. And there's just no way around it. It's all hard work, work that no one really talks about. So I want to explain exactly what makes this portion of the curve so hard to climb, and honestly, whether you should even bother with the attempt. All right, so you've got these 7 mistakes, each of which will fall into one of 3 categories. First, you've got your careless errors, things like forgetting to flip the sign, entering the value of X when the question was asking for the value of Y, or giving your answer in miles instead of meters. If I asked you, what will you do differently in your next test to avoid careless errors, what would you say? That you'll look harder? That you'll check your work more carefully? What you're missing is that checking your work is entirely its own skill, with a bunch of different components to it. Listen, I've done thousands of hours of private tutoring, and every student I've ever had has made careless errors. And believe me, you all make the same errors in the same places. So if we're sitting together working on a problem, I will always know where your mistake is, even if you don't. And because careless errors are so hard to spot, even if I tell you there's a mistake, even if I give you 2, 5, even 10 minutes, I guarantee you, you won't find the mistake if you don't know what to look for. Rereading your work linearly is pointless, because when you're looking over your work, revising your steps in exactly the same way you did the problem the first time, you're just getting faster and faster at completing that set of steps, and that set of steps includes a mistake. You're basically automating an incorrect procedure and becoming more and more cognitively entrenched every time you reread your steps. In other words, do not repeat your steps. Instead, you're going to do at least one of 3 things. You're going to check specific error zones, you're going to ask yourself if your answer makes sense in the broader context, or you're going to solve the problem again from scratch using a different method. So let's talk about the first one, error zones. SAT questions are designed to tease out specific errors that some proportion of the population makes. So say you have an equation like this one. There are 2 steps to solving this problem. First, you move the constant to the right, then you divide by the coefficient. Either one or both of these steps could go wrong. If you get step 1 correct, but mess up step 2 by multiplying instead of dividing, you'll get 20 as an answer. If you get step 1 wrong by forgetting to flip the sign, but you get step 2 correct, you'll end up with 18 over 5. If you mess up both steps, you wind up with 90 as an answer. And of course, all 4 of these numbers will show up as possible answer choices in the real test. These 2 spots here are error zones. They're nodes on the tree where some significant portion of the population takes a wrong turn. You've got to check these error zones specifically. Ignore everything else. Here you'll ask yourself, did I flip the sign? And here, did I multiply instead of divide? These error zones are the most likely places that you will find mistakes, so you must check them with a skeptical eye. Do not gloss over them. All right, so the second way to avoid careless errors is to perform some common sense checks. Does the angle look right? Are my lines perpendicular? Is the after-tax price higher than the pre-tax price? So your answers must make sense in the broader context of the problem. When you ignore the context, you'll wind up with absurd answers like negative distances or parallel lines that cross, and you won't even notice. And that's because you're way too zoomed in. So before moving on to the next question, take a second to zoom out and ask yourself, does my answer make sense? Okay, so the third way to avoid careless errors is to learn multiple approaches to solving every problem. This is by far the most time-consuming and cognitively demanding of the three, but it's also the only way you will realistically reach an 800. So, yes, you've understood correctly. I'm telling you that you need to learn how to solve a problem that you already know how to solve in an entirely different way. This may seem like a waste of time, but it isn't. If you only know how to solve a problem in one way, then you probably do not know the best way of solving that problem. And even if you do know the best way, but only the best way of solving that problem, that means you've got fundamental gaps in your understanding of the math. And this will inevitably hold you back in other spots. Finding more efficient solutions will also vastly reduce your chances of making a careless error in the first place. An approach with two steps has only two error zones. Every time you add a line of algebra, you add multiple error zones, and the decision tree gets larger and more complex. So the more times you touch pen to paper, the more likely you are to make a mistake. Think of this like brain surgery. Make clean cuts and touch only what you need to. When you understand more tricks and approaches, you'll make better strategic decisions and you'll be able to tell intuitively when something has gone wrong. When you only know one approach, it's like you're driving with one eye closed. You lose perspective. Learn multiple methods and you will immediately see a significant drop in your careless errors. Okay, so let's move on to the second kind of error, the one that doesn't stem from content gaps, but rather from performance failure under pressure. So you understand the concept. You've seen a bunch of questions like it, and yet, during the actual test, you can't quite piece it together. So why does this happen? Well, your capacity to retain relevant information for immediate use is known as your working memory. It's the space the mind allocates to immediate tasks like recalling the name of a person you've just met, counting your change at the cash register, or choosing which buses and trains you'll need to catch to get from A to B. In high-pressure environments, a considerable amount of this space is lost to stress. You obsess over your performance, you're fixated on the kid who keeps coughing, you become hyper-aware of your own sweaty palms. And all of this cuts your working memory in half, meaning that any methods you've learned that require a large degree of working memory will fail. You simply do not have the bandwidth. In fact, if you're scoring around 700, you are especially at risk of choking, because your approaches to problems are going to be more complex than those of students scoring around a 600. So when the pressure starts to mount and your available working memory capacity is reduced, your complex strategies become too complex to execute. And this is why having multiple methods to solve a problem is so crucial. Clever shortcuts obviously cut out steps and reduce mental bandwidth, but more straightforward approaches are critical to understand too. Even if a simple approach takes longer, the ease of applying it may make all the difference. All right. The third kind of mistake comes from the hardest problems on the test, the ones that show up near the end of Module 2 and are designed to separate the 770s from the 800s. I call these outliers. They're exceptionally difficult questions that only a tiny percent of the student population gets right. These questions don't necessarily introduce new ideas. In fact, they're often just combinations or twists on concepts you've already seen. Finding the number of solutions, using special triangles, defining functions, symmetry. But the difference is in the arrangement. These questions combine familiar mechanics in unfamiliar ways, and unless you've seen the pattern before, it's incredibly difficult to piece everything together in the moment, especially under time pressure. Take a look at these questions side by side. Let's call them variant A and variant B. They're almost identical. Both are quadratics in the general form with one or two unknown constants. Both have at least one solution, and in both cases, you're tasked with finding some maximum value related to the constants. The first question, variant A, is fairly straightforward if and only if you know the trick, which is to set the discriminant greater than or equal to zero. Simplifying the inequality brings us to the result that AC must be less than or equal to 7,744. So the greatest possible value of AC is, well, 7,744, which is pretty neat. However, if you try to apply this method to variant B, you run into a problem. After discarding the negative case, you're left with the statement that B must be at least 97.57. So you have a minimum value of B, but you know nothing about the maximum, which is what we're looking for. And that's because these problems are only superficially related. Variant B isn't about the discriminant at all. It's about combinatorics. To create your quadratic from two factors, your first terms need to multiply to give 34, and your last terms need to multiply to give 70. You can then calculate the value of B based on your initial assumptions. But this is just one possible value. Change your assumptions, and your B value changes too. Since there are 4 factors of 34 and 8 factors of 70, there are 32 possible permutations. But half of these are reflections of the other half, so there really are only 16 combinations to test out. And the largest of these will result in a B value of 2,381. Again, here there's a trick, but I'll be covering that in detail in a future video. For now, the point I'm making is that even if you are highly competent and swimming in leftover time, you will face a question that is close to impossible to solve without advanced knowledge of the underlying structure. Accepting that you may not be capable of solving this problem in the real test is crucial, because if you do not accept this reality, if you are hell-bent on getting an 800, you will rush through the easy and mid-level questions, you will fail to check your work, and you will make 3 to 4 mistakes that you usually don't make in mock tests. Then, when you get to that very hard question at the end, I promise you, you will get that one wrong too. Your score will collapse, and you won't even know it, because you are convinced you got everything right, right up until that last hard one. What you need to understand is that solving these problems requires an enormous amount of fluency with easier ones, especially those that involve dense algebra. You must be able to recognize underlying templates, manipulate expressions, and assess multiple approaches to a problem in your head before even setting pen to paper. All skills you only develop by solving a lot of problems in many different ways. So if you are determined to get an 800, you must learn multiple methods for everything, especially the algebra-heavy questions that seem routine. Because when the SAT stitches those routines together into something more complex, you'll only recognize the underlying mechanics if you've built real flexibility. Okay. So we've got our 3 mistake types, careless errors, working memory overload, and outliers. And we've got one common approach to fixing these 3 types of mistakes, which is to learn how to solve problems in multiple ways. The issue here, of course, is that learning so many different approaches can take an inordinate amount of time, which raises the question, is it worth it? And this brings us to opportunity cost. Opportunity cost is the value of what you give up when you choose one option over another. It's not just about money. It's about time, energy, and focus. Every hour you spend chasing perfection in one area is an hour you're not spending on something else that might matter more in the long run. Suppose you spend 100 hours trying to get from a 770 to an 800 in the math. Those same 100 hours could have been spent launching a personal project, writing a research paper, building an app, or just diving deeply into a subject that you care about. The truth is, the pursuit of mastery in any skill follows the same Pareto distribution. Early progress is fast and exciting, but eventually your progress slows dramatically as the complexity and nuance of the project explodes. This part of the curve is also where 99% of people quit. So the real value in any project isn't here, it's here. Listen, if you know exactly what you'd rather be doing with 100 hours of your time, don't let your parents, your guidance counselor, or your own mind convince you to obsess over 10 to 20 points on the SAT. Clickbait videos with thumbnails proclaiming how easy it is to get an 800 are lying to you, and they're setting an unrealistic standard. And even if you are capable of getting an 800, you must build the discipline and acquire the wisdom to accept that just because you are capable of learning something doesn't mean that you must learn that thing. In the words of Michael Porter, the essence of strategy is choosing what not to do. And on the flip side, don't let social norms prevent you from pushing as hard and as fast as you possibly can into a project or field of knowledge. The education system is designed to keep the flock moving in the same direction, but there is nothing stopping you from learning whatever you want to learn right now. There is no rule preventing you from reading the next chapters of your textbook, and there's no reason you can't build something real for real people in the real world right now. Don't get me wrong, it will be much, much harder than anything else you have ever done, but that is exactly why it is worth your time.